So now I am going to talk about the topic bottom up parsing technique. It is one of the part of parsing. It is also known as ship reducing parsing. It is used to construct a parse tree for an input string beginning from the bottom, that is the leaves, and move to work towards the top, that is the roots. It reduces the string to the start symbol of the grammar. During the reduction, a specific substring matching the right side or body of the production will be replaced by a non-terminal at the head of that production. It constructs a rightmost derivation in reverse order while scanning the input from left to right. Now, shift reducing parsing is a type of bottom-up parser where a stack holds the grammar symbol and an input buffer holds the rest of the string, that is to say, to be parsed. A general shift reduced parsing is LR parsing. The L stands for scanning the input from left to right, and R stands for constructing a rightmost derivation in reverse. Here is a simple diagram for bottom up parsing, as we can see. Okay, the next slide. Let's move on to some terminologies. Augmented grammar. It will be generated if we add one more production in the given grammar G. It helps the parser to identify when to stop the parsing and announce the acceptance of the input. In the example, we can see that the given grammar, which is denoted by the capital G, is capital S is equal to capital AA, and capital A is equal to small a capital A bar B. Now the augmented grammar, which is denoted by G complement, that is S complement, is S, which is added here, the part, and S is equals to AA, and rest of the line, that is same, it will become here capital A is equals to small a capital A and bar B. Now the next is closure operation. If I is a set of items for a grammar G, then closure I is a set of items constructed from I by two rules. At first, initially every item in one is added to the closure I. Secondly, if A is equals to alpha into B beta is in closure I, and B is gamma and is a production, then add the items B is equals to dot gamma, then I. If it is not ready already there, we apply this rule until no more items can be added to the closure I. In the example, S complement is S. S is equals to AA. Capital A is equals to A capital A slash B. Now closure is S complement is equals to S, that is equals to S complement is equals to dot S. Since it is non-terminal, so production of S is added, as we can see in this diagram. So S is equals to dot AA. Here it is non-terminal after dot, so production of A is added. Then is A is equals to dot AA capital A, I'm sorry, slash dot B. Next is closure. S is equals to A into A, that is equals to S capital A dot A then is equals to dot A capital A slash dot B. Then third is closure A, that is equals to dot small a and capital A, that is equals to A given by A small a into capital A. So now next slide is action. This function takes as arguments a state I and a terminal A. The value of action, that is IA, can have one of the four forms. First is shift J, where J is a state, and second, reduced by grammar production, A is equals to beta. Third is accept, and fourth is error. And again, the next is coming to go to. This function takes a state and grammar symbol as arguments and produces a state. If go to capital I small I comma A is equals to IJ, the go to also maps a state small I and non-terminal A to state small j. Thank you. Now the next topic would further be continued by Shaikat.
Thank you. Now we come to the classification of the bottom-up parsers. Now the bottom-up parsers can be classified into four types: LR0, SLR1, which is known as simple LR, the CLR, which is known as canonical LR, and the LALR, which is also known as look-ahead LR. Here the L stands for left-to-right scanning of the input, and the R stands for rightmost derivation in reverse. Now it is a production of the grammar with exactly one dot on the right-hand side of the production. It is used to indicate how much of the input has been scanned up to a given point. In LR0, we place the reduced mode in the entire row of the relevant state in the parsing table. Now, next is the SLR1 parser. It is same as the LR0 parser, but it has a reduced production entry which is written according to the follow of the reduced production variable. Thus, the reduced mode is not placed in the entire row. The next is the CLR parser. The CLR parsing uses LR1 items where look-ahead length is k to define the LRK items. So, LR1 parsers are more powerful with the look-ahead item applied to it. The last is the LALR parser. It is like the CLR parser, but while CLR parsers have two states in the look-ahead part, the states are combined in the LALR parser. When the parsing table shows no grammar conflict, it is called LALR grammar. Next slide. Here is the relation among the bottom-up parsing types. At the center is the LR0 parser. Outside it is the SLR parser. Outside LR0 and SLR is the LALR parser, and the last is the CLR parser. Next slide. Now we'll see some benefits of LR parsing. First is it can handle large class of context-free grammar. Then except C++ and Perl, many programming languages use some variations of LR parser. Then it can be implemented very efficiently, and LR parsers can detect syntax errors very fast. But there are also a few drawbacks of LR parsing, such as it can be tiring to construct LR parser by hand and thus needs an automated parser generator. Also, if the grammar has any ambiguities or other constructs, then it is difficult for LR parsing. Thank you. Next slide will be explained by Sonushri.
Thank you, Shrikot. So now we will see some examples. We will perform SLR parsing for the grammar, and our grammar is S produces L is equal to R/R, L produces *R/ID, R produces L. So now we will build an SLR table for the following augmented grammar, that is S dash produces S, S produces L is equal to R, S produces R, L produces *R, L produces ID, and R produces L. So when the parsing will start, we have not, since we have not parsed our input at all, so we will start parsing from S, that is represented by S dash produces dot S. So in order to parse S, we have to parse either L is equal to R or R, and it is represented by S produces dot L is equal to R and S produces dot R. What is closure of a state? If A produces A dot B represents the current state, and B produces Y is a production, then add B produces dot I to the state. Change the slide. So using the closure property, now we will construct LR0 item set, and the first set will be S dash produces dot S, S produces dot L is equal to R, S produces dot R, L produces dot *R, L produces dot ID, and R produces dot L. For the first state, suppose if we are parsing ID, then we will go to the state L gives ID dot. Now if After some steps, we have to parse the input that reduces to an L. Then we will go to the state S produces L dot equal to R and R produces L dot. So before building the parsing table, we have to compute the follow of the sets. So follow of S dash is dollar, follow of S is dollar, follow of L is dollar and equal to, and follow of R is dollar equal to, and the process is numbered as follows. Change the slide. So here are our LR0 item sets. For I0, if we are shifting the dot from corresponding to S, then it will go to item set 1. If we are shifting the dot corresponding to L from I0, it will go to item set 2. If we are shifting the dot corresponding to star, it will go to I5. If we are shifting the dot corresponding to ID, it will go to item set 3. If we are shifting the dot corresponding to R, it will go to I4. If we are shifting the dot corresponding to ID from I5, it will again go back to I3. If we are shifting the dot corresponding to star, it will go to I5 again. And if we are shifting the dot corresponding to equal to from I2, it will go to I6. If we are shifting the dot corresponding to I6, it will go back to I5. If we are shifting the dot corresponding to L, it will go to I7. If we are shifting the dot corresponding to L, it will go to I7. If we are shifting the dot from I5 corresponding to R, it will go to I8. If we are shifting the dot corresponding to R from I6, it will go to I9. And finally, if we are shifting the dot corresponding to ID from I6, we will go back to I3 again. Change the slide. So here is our parsing table. We have the action table as well as the go-to table. The action table has ID equal to star and dollar, and our go-to table has SLR. And here are our states from 0 to 9. In state 0, we have shift operation under ID and star and SLR. In state 1, we have no shift and reduce operations, but the state 1 versus dollar is an accepted state. In state 2, we have both shift and reduction operation under equal to, which gives rise to a conflict. In state 3, we have reduction operations under equal to and dollar. In state 4, we have reduction operations under dollar. In state 5, we have shift operations under ID and star. Similarly, in state 6, we have reduction operations under ID and star. In state 7, we have reduction operations under equal to and dollar. Similarly, in state 8, we have reduction operations under equal to and dollar. And finally, in state 9, we have reduction operation in under R1. So now we see that the shift reduced conflicts occurred in state 2 under equal to. Thank you.
Hi sir, thank you Tonusri. So now I will try to explain another grammar using SLR parsing. So here is the given grammar. S produces capital A, small a, capital A, small b. S produces capital B, small b, capital B, small a. And A has a null production and B has a null production. Here we create an augmented grammar which we use in building our SLR parsing table. So we add this S dash symbol here, and this S dash produces this S. S produces this capital A, small a, capital A, small b. S produces capital B, small b, capital B, small a. And A and B has null productions here. Now, this is the closure operation of our given grammar. So firstly, we can see here from here that S dash produces dot S. S produces dot capital A, small a, capital A, small b. S produces dot capital B, capital B, small a. A produces dot epsilon and B produces dot epsilon. The significance of this dot is that whatever we write after this dot, means on the right hand side of this dot, these things, all these things are yet to be explored or yet to be read. So the main task is that we have to place this dot for each and every production. We have to place this dot after the last symbol or at the extreme position. Now, to make our work simpler, we just make a chart for this follow operation. That follow of S dash is dollar, follow of S is dollar, follow of A is A comma B. We can verify it from here, and follow of B is A comma B. We can verify it from this production. Now, this is the parsing rule. Suppose we are trying to move this capital A from this state. So what can I do? We just place the dot after this A. And now the updated production is S produces capital A dot small a, capital A, small b. And as there is epsilon, so we have no use of this epsilon for making our parsing table. So we just omit it. And we write A produces the dot only. And here is the parsing rules, or the rule of our given grammar, 1, 2, 3, 4. It is not a rule because we add it externally. Now, we are trying to make a parsing diagram here. We see I0 state earlier, that is dash produces dot S, and other things are there. Now we make a move for capital S from I0, and we go to I1 state, and the updated production is now S dash produces S dot. As you can see, that dot is placed at its extreme position, means we have nothing to explore after this dot. So we can say that this is the accepting state. We can accept the grammar from this state because the start symbol is accepted at this point. Now from I0, we make a move for this capital A, and we go to I2 state. And here we can see the updated production is S produces capital A dot small a, capital B, small b. And from I3, we can see that if we make a move from this I0, I3 contains this production, S produces capital B dot small b, capital B, small a. Now, as we have nothing to explore from this state, we directly move to I2 and make a move for this small a, and we go to this I4 state. And the updated production is now S produces capital A small a dot capital A small b, and capital A produces this dot. And we can see that we have nothing to explore from this production. So we can say that this is reduced. So we can term it like that, R3, because from our production rules, we can see that A produces epsilon is rule number 3. So we can say that rule number 3 is reduced here. From I3, we make a move for small b, and we go to this I5 state. And now S produces capital B small b dot capital B small a, and B produces this dot. So now B is reduced completely. We can say this is reduced term 4, and then we move forward that from I4 we make a transition for this capital A and we go to this I6 state, and the updated production is like S produces capital A small a capital A dot small b, and from I5 we make a transition for this capital B and we go to I7 state, and the production is now capital S produces capital B small b capital B dot small a, and from this I6 finally we reached at I8 after transiting this B, and the production is now capital S produces capital A small b capital A small b dot. As you can see, this is now completely reduced because the dot is now placed at the extreme position, so we can name it as R1 because this is our rule number 1. So rule number 1 is also reduced here. Now for the last state, from I7 we make a move for small a, and we reach here. S produces capital B small b capital B small a dot, and now dot is at its extreme position. We have nothing to explore or read, so we can say it as R2 because it is our rule number 2. And if we observe this I0, we can also see that here also A produces a dot only. So we have nothing to explore here. Now we can say it as R3, and we can say it also R4 because B also produces nothing from here, or we can't explore anything from these two. Okay. Now this is the parsing table. So parsing table consists of 3 columns: state, action, go to. State is the number of states on item number which we use in our designed parsing diagram. So here we have 10 states, so we just write 0 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 9 10 states. And action consists all the terminals. Here terminals are small a and small b, and by default it has also dollar, so we write it here. And go to function is actually for the non-terminals or variable, so we write capital A capital B capital A here, as these are the non-terminals in our given grammar. So if we try to make up the connection between our diagram and table, we can easily understand that if we make a transition of this capital A from this state I0, we go to I1 state, so we write 1 under this S. And if we make a transition of this A from I0 state, we go to I2 state. If we make a transition of this B from I0 state, we go to I3 state. Now, as we can see from this diagram, that already in I0 state, this A and B is completely reduced, and follow of A and follow of B are small a and small b both. So we just write R3 and R4 under this A and B. Now for state 1, if we make a move for state 1, it has contained nothing because we already explored all the symbols, whatever we have in that particular production. So we just write except under this dollar because the starting symbol is totally explored here. So symbol is the follow of our starting symbol. Now we write except under this dollar. For state I2, we make a transition of this small a, and we go to the I4 state. So we write S4 here because for terminal symbol, we use this shift operation or shift word because it just move the dot or move the point towards a non-terminal or terminal. Now for state 3, we can see that B is move to the I5 state. So we write just S5 under this B. Now for I4 state, we make a transition for this capital A and we go to I6 state. And as this A is goes to the I6 state, we just write R3 and R3 under this A and B because follow of A is small b and small a. Now, for state I5, we make a transition for this B and we go to I7 state. And in the action portion, we can write that R4 under this small a and R4 under this small b because follow of B is small a and small b. For I6 state, we write S8 under this B because we can move this B from I6 to I8 and this is a terminus, so we write S8 under it. Then for I7 state, we make a transition for this small a and we go to this I9 state and it is a terminal, so we write S9 or shift 9 over here. And lastly, we can see from this diagram that at the state I8, the production rule 1 is completely reduced. So this is accepted over here. So just we write R1 under this dollar sign. And for I9 also, it is accepted over here. It is reduced over here. So we just write R2 under this dollar symbol. But here is a problem that in the cell of 0, A and 0, B, two reduced conflicts are occurring. So that's why we can say that, or we can conclude that the given grammar is not an SLR grammar. Thank you, sir. The next part will be continued by Swati.
Thank you, Shuchishmita. Okay, so now I will be basically dealing with some important questions of compiler design, which has even come in GATE. These are the GATE level questions. So in the first question, it is asking us that which one of the following grammars is free from left recursion. So what is left recursion? So left recursion is the production of the grammar in which the leftmost variable of its RHS is same as the variable of its LHS. So here we can see that in option A, C, and D, they are showing left recursion, but only option B is over here, which is free from left recursion. So the correct answer for this will be option B. In second question, it is asking us which one of the following statements is false. So in option A, it is telling us that context-free grammar can be used to specify both lexical.
Change slide is not change. Thank you. Old slide, second question.
No, sir. Second question is over here only.
I'm sorry.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Carry on.
Yes, sir. So in second question, it is telling, it is asking that which one of the following statements is false. So the first option is telling us that context-free grammar can be used to specify both lexical and syntax rules. And we know that this statement is true. And option C is telling us high-level language programs can be translated to different intermediate representations. It is also true. And option D is telling arguments to a function can be passed using the program stack. It is also true. But the option B, it is saying us that type checking is done before parsing. It is false, as type checking is usually done after parsing. Next slide, please. This is the set 2 get level questions. So over here it is asking us that in a compiler, keywords of a language are recognized during, so it is the keywords of the language in a compiler are generally recognized during the lexical analysis of the program. So what is lexical analysis? Lexical analysis is basically the first phase of the compiler, which is also known as a scanner. It converts the high level input program into a sequence of tokens. Lexical analysis can be implemented with the deterministic finite automata. In fourth question, it is telling us which data structure in a compiler is used for managing information about variables and their attributes. So its answer will be symbol table, as abstract syntax tree are generally the data structures which are widely used in compilers to represent the structure of a program code. It often serves as an intermediate representation of the program through several stages that the compiler requires and has a strong impact on the final output of the program. Symbol table, so it shows the symbols, and parse table, it generally refers to the table driven versions of an LR parser using tables derived from a grammar by a parser generator. An LR parser also uses tables derived from a grammar. So the only option left with us is semantic stack, which is the data structure and compiler that is generally used for managing information about variables and their attributes. Next slide. Okay, so here in question number 5, it is telling that S produces A, capital S, capital B, D, and capital B produces small b. So it is asking us the number of reduction steps taken by a bottom up parser while accepting the string AAA, DBBB is. So at first, what will happen is that S will first replace D as S produces D. Then in the next step, what will happen is that S will then replace ASB as S produces the ASB. In the third step, S will replace the ASBB, and so for doing this, at the seventh step we will get only S. So the total number of reduction steps which we required for this bottom up parser is 7. Now in the last k-8 level question over here is that which one of the following kinds of derivation is used by LR parsers. So we generally know that LR parsers uses rightmost in reverse. Next slide. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Very good presentation.